cardboard box, like a shipping box, this cardboard box, coat it with paraffin to protect it from the elements, and just slide that right over the hive. Be sure you have openings. You want an opening for the bees to go in and out. You want an opening for upper ventilation. Upper ventilation is very important. So if you do not have any opening at the top, the very, very top, for about a quarter of an inch, it doesn't have to be all the way across, although I have opening all the way across. Some people just stick in pennies to make a 16th of an inch opening. But that hot air, as the air comes in from outside, it's heated. It absorbs lots of moisture from the bees that are eating the honey. That air rises to the top, condenses because the inner cover is cold, it condenses and rains down on the bees and kills your colony. The upper ventilation allows that air to come up and through and out the other opening. That is very important. If you don't have that upper ventilation, and you go out to your bees in January and open them up, that inner cover will be coated with water. Then when it starts to rain down the bees, you will lose your colony. So you have to have, some people just have maybe an inch opening at the top, inch by, half an inch or so, that's fine. I insulate all the way across. I mean, I open all the way across about a quarter of an inch. But that upper entrance is very important. So when you, if you do bind your hives with some type of insulation, be sure you have that upper opening and a lower opening for the bees. Oh, and you want your lower entrance to be reduced to 3/8 of an inch. So if you buy the commercial bottom board, on one side you have 3/4 of an inch, you turn it over and you have 3/8 of an inch. Now what the bee books tell you is, when winter time comes, go in there, take all your supers off, all your hive bodies off, reverse the bottom board so that you have a 3/8 inch opening. Sometimes they'll say, leave the 3/4 of an inch and insert a strip of wood so that you only have 3/8 of an inch. Frankly, I think that's a waste of time. Just use the 3/8 of an inch all year round. You'll have plenty of ventilation. You have more ventilation 3/4 in the summertime. It's a waste of time. Always use the 3/8 of an inch. You never have a problem with mice getting in. You have plenty of ventilation, and you don't have to go to the trouble of inserting that 3/4 of an inch or changing your entrance by reversing the bottom board. So just stay with 3/8 inch year round, and you don't have to worry about mice. So sometimes the weather gets nasty in November and you haven't put your insert in. Well, you say, I'm not going to bother to go out there now. The mice get in. And the damage they do is terrible. So, and then some beekeepers will say, well, you need that extra ventilation in the summertime of 3/4 of an inch. You don't. Stay with 3/8. I've done 3/8 for years. I have plenty of ventilation, and I don't have to worry about going out and putting a strip in to get rid of the mice. Nothing is worse than getting mice in your colony. So just keep the bottom board year-round, 3/8 of an inch. Now, one of the things you want to be sure is that your colony has enough honey to get through the winter. Apparently here in Omaha, you have to leave at least a small intermediary super of honey on the hive. In Wichita, I used to strip all the honey off. I took every bit of honey off the hive and fed them sugar syrup. And honey then was selling for $15 a gallon, and sugar syrup is, what, $2.50 a gallon? I would strip everything off and just feed them sugar syrup through the winter. You can't do that here. You gotta leave some honey on. And how much? If you can leave a whole deep super of honey, high body of honey, that's better. But they should at least have a small super, an intermediate super of honey on. Now, one of the things you wanna do is, assume there's a bottom board here. There's a bottom board here. You want to get under the bottom board and what we call heft it. Do this with the whole hive. If it's really heavy, I mean like lead, your hive's in good shape for the winter. It'll be in good shape till January or February.
and it has plenty of honey. So remember, you're gonna have at least two hive bodies or a hive body in the super. So get your hand under that bottom board and what we call a hefting. Try to lift it up. Oh boy, if it weighs 100, 125 pounds, it's really heavy, you're in good shape. If it feels like an empty cardboard box, you've got to feed. Okay? If it's just somewhere in between, well, you know, maybe December or January, you'll have to feed. So oftentimes you'll go in this time of the year and boy, that feels like an empty cardboard box. Okay. Then you then feed syrup, sugar syrup, at a ratio of 2 to 1. In the spring, you feed 1 to 1. In the fall, this late in the fall, you should feed 2 to 1. You can still feed 1 to 1 now for maybe another month to encourage brood rearing. But as you get into middle of October, 2 to 1. Now, what do we mean by 2 to 1? This can be either volume or weight. That is 1 cup of sugar and 1/2 cup of water. 2 cups of sugar, 1 cup of water. 1 pound of water, 2 pounds of sugar. So either 2 to 1 by weight or by volume. It doesn't make any difference.
Just for the record, 2 cups of water equals 1 pound.
So, yeah, there's some ratio like that, yeah. And so that's why it doesn't make any difference whether you do it by volume or weight. In the springtime, when you want to feed 1 to 1, if you have gallon jars like this, these are very nice gallon jars, 1 to 1, I just throw in a 5 pound or a 4 pound bag of sugar, fill the rest of it up with warm water, and that is a 1 to 1.
And do you just shake it and go and it's done?
Just stir it up.
You don't have to cook it or nothing?
Oh, no. Just, we should put hot water in. If you're going to 2 to 1 ratio, you've got to use hot water because the sugar will precipitate out. You turn it upside down to feed the colony, sugar precipitates out and you plug up the holes. So you want to use hot water, fairly hot water, with 2 to 1 ratio. And this is one of the best ways of feeding right over the cluster. Now be sure it's glass, not plastic. Plastic starts to implode. As it's drained out and the vacuum is created above here, the plastic jar implodes, it just drains the lot. So you want to eat with glass. Now, some of the catalogs feature inboard feeders, that is a something that looks like a frame made out of black plastic. Those are all right for another few weeks. They're worthless in December, January, February. This is the only way, other than candy board, this is the only way to feed them when you start getting real cold. These feeders that fit into the entrance, and the jar sits outside the entrance, they're worthless when it starts getting cold. The bees just don't move. They'll move upward to get the syrup. And the reason they can move upward to get the syrup is the assumption is that there's honey always above them that they can move up and get to the syrup. But if over here sits an inboard feeder or one of those feeders that fits into the entrance, they won't move, they'll starve. So this is the only way other than candy board to feed when you start getting into the cooler weather.
How does it feed out of there? You're upside down, is there a hole or something in that, or?
But those are really the best jars. Those are what I call quarter turns, but I think maybe they're only an eighth of a turn. They turn just an eighth of a turn when they lock in place.
So does it seep out of there? Is that what you're saying?
It's a vacuum seal. It'll hold itself up.
See, when you turn it upside down, a little bit will drain out. Okay.
And then
the vacuum will hold it and the rest of it in, and the bees just suck it down.
And you just set that right on top of the frame.
Right on top of the cluster. Yeah, right.
And then with the box on top to protect it.
That's right.
Joe?
Joe, can you pass that around so the rest of us can see it?
Interesting. You want to see it?
Yeah.
These are just mayonnaise jars or pickle jars. When you drill holes, you drill from the inside out. 1/16 of an inch or a 55, number 55 drill works fine. Drill from the inside out because, and then I usually sand it with a little bit of sandpaper, because the bees proboscis goes in, and if you drill in out, it's barbed and she rips her proboscis apart. So you drill inside out, I didn't rub a little bit of sand.
And then where is that on the?
Okay, just put just a little bit of wood, like a quarter of an inch of wood strips, set right on top of the top bars, the wood strips below. Put a little bit of Vaseline on the threads so that when you go to clean it later on, you don't have a hard time getting it off. So just rub a little Vaseline on the threads.
If you were feeding honey, that same feeder, would that work for honey?
If you feed them honey, you should really mix the honey with water, half and half. Feed them that way. And I've never fed them honey this, other than in the cold, this late in. When I get into spring, if I have old honey, I mix it half and half with water and feed it to them.
Okay, but if you were, so what you're saying is use comb honey in some kind of a container?
Well, you can wrap it into a frame if you want to just wrap a string around it. But usually what I mean is I keep a certain amount of my honey aside in the frame, just as the bees make it, and feed that back to them.
We actually tried it with the wild swarm, I think I talked to you about it, and tried putting it into some kind of a feeder, like the one that's got the grating on there. I think it's for actually sugar water. But the bees tended to drown in that. They get stuck in there and go down there. And that was why I wondered what was safe to.
Let me show you this.
I don't want to interrupt you.
No, that's all right. This is part of my talk here. This is one of the best feeders that I know of. When it's reasonably warm, and actually it can be kind of cold, and you set this right down on the top bars, what it is a chicken feeder. I make this separate from what I buy because it prevents the bees from drowning. The bees will drown in here. But this thing uncouples like this, you turn it upside down, you pour in a gallon of syrup, you put this on, put the threads on, turn it back up like this, set on top of the bees. They'll take this syrup down very, very fast. And one of the nice things about this is that if you feed them 2-1, you don't have to worry about the holes getting plugged up. You got a big opening here, right here, so the syrup comes out. Again, it's the vacuum. What's nice about this is it's self-modulating. When they take syrup down and this hole gets open, then more fluid flows in. Of course, then when the fluid comes up the hole, the vacuum takes over and holds it in. They can sometimes, even when it's cold, like in November or so, they can take a gallon down sometimes in 2 or 3 days. They really take this down fast. And I prefer using this for a 2-1 mixture in the fall and in the winter.
Can I look at the bottom of that?
That's not wax or
polymer. How does it not freeze in the winter?
Okay, now about freezing. I know for a fact that 1-1 will not freeze at 20 below zero. I've had a lot of experience feeding bees 1-1, and it's 20 below zero for several days. The syrup will get like frosty, this ice cream mix and sort of stuff, frosty. It won't get solid and break the glass, it just gets frosty. Like, that's 1-1. 2-1, of course, has more impurities in the water, so it's going to freeze at a lower temperature. So you don't have to worry about the jar freezing and breaking, unless it gets below 20 below. I've never had them been below 20 below. So starting now, if you got light colonies, think about 2-1.